It's the calm before the storm in California. It's the calm before the storm in the world, right? But what we'll do is we'll stay calm during the storm, okay? So we're not going to allow the world to dictate to us how we feel, because we're going to use skillful means to recognize the shock, block the panic, allow the shock to settle, and pay no attention. Let the dead bury the dead. Pay no attention to the world. What is the world really? There's been so many have tried to say what the world is, but it's very simple. It's something that we collectively are imagining. It's a great collective effort by many aspects of spirit to for the purpose of giving an excuse for our doubt. We want to doubt God, and we say, well, look, this world helps us doubt God. This is why we doubt God, right? God didn't make this world. It's the effort of our own imagination. It's a mental projection. It's just like a reflection of our thoughts. It's our thoughts being reflected to us, thoughts of doubt. And so it's a training ground. It's for doubt. We come to this world, what do? We doubt God. We doubt certainty. We doubt certainty. It trains us to doubt certainty. It helps us doubt certainty. That's the world. Now, we don't have to see the world this way. If we give up trying to doubt, then the world, it remains, but it's transformed into something extremely beautiful and lovely. That's what Jesus tells us. And so I have no reason to disbelieve what he has to say. He says, loosen the world from all the thoughts that you have about it. Set it free from all thoughts that you've ever had about it, and it will return to you in a transformed state. It'll be so kind and gentle and lovely, astonishing. Now, I've yet to experience this, although I have set the world free of my thoughts to what I feel is quite an extent. So, but I feel eventually I will experience this, and everyone will. And this is what salvation is. Is we stop, we say, you know what? I don't need to. Actually, doubt has no cause. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to say that there's a cause of doubt. So the world seems to cause doubt, doesn't it? It tends to cause doubt. We think it's causing doubt. So a great excuse for us. But in reality, there's no cause of doubt at all. Absolutely none. Doubt, we just chose to doubt. It's not anything that happened due to a cause at all. So we use this world, we've imagined this world as a device that seems to be causing doubt in us about God. Like we say, like, God, I don't know, the world that you made, really, we kind of doubt that you're really God. Well, in order to doubt God, we have to believe that God made this world. And as soon as we believe that this is a God's creation, this world, then automatically we're gonna doubt God, right? We say, wait a minute, everything's dying, everything's imperfect. Wow, I really got some severe doubts about God deep down. This is why we made the world. And yet, if we give up claiming that God made the world, then it alters the equation, and we become dharmic. We begin to say, hey, wait a minute. All I need to do is tell the world, hey, you don't need to do anything for me. You don't need to try to be a cause of anything for me. You're free. Set the world free. Set everything free in the world. This is the way. This is the way. So, it's interesting. The ancient sacrificial religions, what they do is they would sacrifice an animal to their god. And it's very interesting because the animals that they chose, okay, this came to me today, it's very profound. The animals that they chose, they tried to get ones that were without blemish, perfect. A perfect dove, a perfect lamb, you know, this, something like that. Always tried to be perfect, the very best. And then they killed this animal to please their god. Well, What they're really doing is trying to kill perfection. Okay, kill perfection. So they feel that their God is greatly pleased by the death of perfection. So what is their God? Their God must be a God of doubt. And it must be their own self that they're trying to please. That our belief in doubt, the belief in doubt that we have, trying to be really different than God and greater than God, we sacrifice, try to sacrifice perfection to this God to please it. So it says, oh yeah, I really love that. But what we're really trying to do is we're trying to learn to love doubt. Now the culmination of the sacrificial system, just to show you know, silly we are, trying to learn to love doubt, is Jesus. Because they had been sacrificing all these animals, and yet still they hadn't learned to love doubt. And they think that they thought that, well, God demands an even greater sacrifice, and we've been sacrificing animals. But what if we do the human sacrifice and sacrifice a perfect human, with a human without blemish? That would really satisfy God, wouldn't it? Because then God would, we felt that, well, the animals aren't quite like us, but we haven't quite shown God that we're willing to sacrifice our own perfection. We've been sacrificing animals' perfection, but our own perfection, we're willing to do that, then God will finally be pleased with us and say, oh, well done, I'm so pleased with you that you hate perfection so much that you took a perfect human and sacrificed that perfect human to me. So now I love you so much, and because I love you so much, you're going to be happy with doubt now. This is how I see it. This is what took place there. Pretty amazing. But if you see it like I saw it today, I just said, oh my gosh, that's it. That's why they tried to sacrifice. Reality is perfection, total certainty. There's no doubt at all, none. So when we choose doubt, it's like we're afraid of reality. And so we imagine then there's this God of doubt who's protecting us from reality, but this God seems feeble. So we try to make this God stronger by sacrificing our ideas of perfection. There's a perfect dove, let us sacrifice this animal and get rid of perfection in so doing, so that this imaginary God of doubt will feel stronger and like can say, oh yes, I can tell that you really hate perfection and you want to get rid of it. So I will help you with that. I will protect you. It's a psychic mechanism. This sacrifice is to an idol, really, an idol that of our own making, our own mind has made this idol to try to protect us from reality. And so they thought if we say that Jesus is this perfect human, see, the sacrifice we thought would only work if Jesus was human. So they made up this notion that of duophysitism, of two natures, divine and human. But it's for the sacrificial purpose of the sacrifice, they had to believe that Jesus was human, that God had become flesh, but it was perfect flesh. And then they sacrificed this perfect flesh. And they said, okay, you see, we were able to sacrifice the perfection of God. And this really pleases our God. It's silly, isn't it? And yet, this is something that seems to have, you know, has captured our imagination for thousands and thousands of years in terms of how important sacrifice is. But, you know, this saves us. People take it very seriously. It saves us from what? Real perfection, God, the real God. So the fake God, our imaginary idol God, is supposed to save us from the perfection of the real God by sacrificing perfection to the idol. It's really simple when you see it, totally simple and silly. It's only when we take silliness seriously, it becomes very complex and confusing. But when we just say, look, it's absolutely silly, then it's easy to see. And you just say, ha, yeah, what silliness that is. And of course, the idea of believing that the sacrifice of Jesus is supposed to mean that now you get the protection from this God who loves, who's so pleased that we sacrifice our own perfection for this God's sake, our own perfection. Because keep in mind that they said Jesus is both divine and human, God made flesh. So we weren't just sacrificing any human, any old human. Okay. The idea really was that we were sacrificing God, the perfection of God, getting rid of it, and then being rewarded for having done that, showing how loyal we are to that notion of doubt, that we're doubting God. Doubt, it's lack of certainty, isn't it? Perfection is what? Certainty. It's absolutely certain that truth is true everywhere. There's only, there's no truth that is not true, completely true. There's no truth that is not completely true. So I'm just putting this out here. So it may not be crystal clear to you as I explain it, because my explanation, it has not been smoothed out totally. But it came upon me today where I saw this so clearly. Just, oh gosh, okay, that's the silliness of what we've been doing. These Christians have this. Now, not all Christianity is centered so much on that, but a lot has been over the years. The vicarious atonement, the sacrifice of Jesus. You must accept the, sacrifice of Jesus. It's the atonement for your sins, and that God has accepted that in place of your sacrifice. So that God is made strong. That means God will not protect you from what? From certainty, from perfection. Because you say you because this you said I sacrificed my perfection to God, so it's not doesn't exist anymore. Jesus' death got rid of my own perfection, and it makes us gives us this feeling of safety from what? From continuity fear. What we fear is certainty. We're terrified of certainty because we're so used to trying to worship doubt that certainty seems like an abyss to us. And so we do everything we can think of to protect us from this, what we think is an abyss. So that's why we make up an imaginary God, please, God of doubt and uncertainty and doubt that is made powerful enough to protect us through our proving to God that we don't really love perfection. We're willing to get rid of perfection. That's why they had to make Jesus say he was divine and human, because say he's divine. In other words, we're proving that we're willing to get rid of our divine perfection, you see. And then we think then this has protected us. So people go to church and believe they're protected now by the cross, by the sacrifice of Jesus. Now they're going to keep on believing that, but we don't have to. We don't have to believe such nonsense in terms of that, the whole dynamic there is just, totally egoic, fear-based silliness. We cannot sacrifice our perfection. It's impossible. It is what we are. Certainty, truth is certain. Truth is certain. There's no doubt in truth, none whatsoever. Nothing to cause doubt in reality. There's nothing to cause doubt at all. The doubt is just a whimsical desire on our part, and nothing more than that. So nothing has to protect doubt. We can say you don't need to protect doubt, the world. You don't need to protect doubt. You don't need to pretend to be causing doubt anymore. So when you tell the world, world, you don't need. For my sake, you don't need to continue pretending to be the cause of my of doubt. Okay, it's totally my own, just silly desire to believe in doubt. That's the only cause there is. There's no other cause than just a whimsical desire on my part. So, world, you don't need to appear to be the cause of my doubt anymore. And if we can just keep that mantra going, then I believe. This that we will see a world transformed. Okay, we will see a world transformed. This is what Jesus absolutely tells us in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. And so I believe what he says. I believe what he says. So I'm preparing for that. I'm making the right steps, you might say. Making the right steps. It may seem like a difficult step. Speaking of steps, taking difficult steps, I did something today I've never done before, which is going upstairs four at a time. Four at a time. Now, I've done one at a time. Very good at that. Two at a time. I'm very good at that. I even did three at a time. I even ran three at a time. But four at a time is a totally different ball game. Totally. You lose the leverage you have. The angle becomes so steep with your body, and the stretch is so great. It's completely different. Doing two at a time is actually just as easy as one at a time, maybe even better. It just seems very not nice. And three at a time is like you're really extending yourself about as far as your natural leverage can allow. But when you go to four at a time, boy, did I have trouble, but I did it. So I did four at a time. So it's something difficult to do, and I had to get help by the guardrail, help pull myself up and steady and pull myself up because by my legs alone, I couldn't generate the lift. It's too great of a stretch. So it was really an ordeal, but I did it. And this may be similar to letting unbinding the world from our demand that it seemed to be the cause of our doubt, cause of doubt. It may seem to be really difficult to do, like really a stretch, okay? But you could get some help. Get some help. That's what I did. And I was humble enough to say, I'm going to use this guardrail, grab a hold, and help pull me up four stairs at a time as I use my legs, my whole body, my legs. And it takes a whole body effort to do that. The whole core, legs, upper body, everything to do four at a time, keep doing that. Wow. What a workout. That's probably the best work I've ever had. It was so difficult. But I did it. I did it. And so it may seem difficult to free the world from our demand that it be the cause of our doubt. But just imagine in doing so, will not the world stand transformed in our sight? How could it not? How could it not? How could it not? And how's the audio going here? It's probably, I don't know. Will it sound okay? Doesn't sound very good. Doesn't sound okay. Uh-oh. Wow. What's going on here? There's no volume to it. This is really something. So all this has been wasted. Okay, well, that's pretty amazing. Everything is pumped up to 100% here. Why is it not? Well, that beep was nice and loud in the earphones. But okay, so my headphone jack was not working properly. Okay, so we are doing good. That's great. Hasn't been lost. Awesome. I was worried, like, uh-oh, all this effort has been lost. Oh, that's great. That's great. That's great. Just have this heat pack on because it's quite cold out here. Really. We get ready for three storms in California. It's just going to come blasting through, and we're just going to get hammered about the next 6 days. Wind and rain hammering us. Which is great. Take everything we can get. So we're digging deep here, and it may be difficult for you, but today I just decided I'm going to try four. The Holy Spirit told me four. I said, four? You got to be joking. You got to be kidding me. And I said, what the heck? Why not try it? I said, uh-oh. That's different. I need help. So to do something difficult, we need help. I use the guardrail. It's humble enough. Nobody else is using the guardrail to go upstairs, but I use the guardrail because I was doing four at a time. And you're not gonna be able to do four at a time unless you're trying to run and leap. But I was just stretching my legs and then just stepping four at a time. And you won't be able to do it unless you get some assist like that. Pretty much so. I don't know how else you could do it. Maybe with practice you might be able to. I don't know. It's such a stretch. If you have real long legs, it might be different, but normal legs, no. Four stairs is you're going past your comfort zone there to a big extent. But it'll probably make three seem easy now, won't it? Like three, like, oh, that's no problem at all. Well, that's the benefit of it. But this letting go, setting the world free of trying to prove to us that it's the cause of our doubt, cause of doubt. This may seem like, oh, it's so difficult, but I'm doing it. I'm doing it. And I say, tree, you don't need to do anything for me. You do not need to do anything for me whatsoever. You're absolutely free. I'm not projecting any desires upon you as what you should do. You don't need to be the source of my doubt whatsoever. And say the ocean, you don't need to do anything for me. There's nothing you need to do for me. Sky, there's nothing you need to do for me. Rocks, there's nothing you need to do for me. Vegetation, there's nothing you need to do for me. Vegetation, nothing whatsoever. I set you completely free. Birds, there's nothing you need to do for me. I set you completely free. Animals, there's nothing you need to do for me. I set you completely free. Insects, there's nothing you need to do for me. I set you completely free. Like that. People, there's nothing you need to do for me. People, I set you completely free. Atmosphere, there's nothing you need to do. Atmosphere for me, not a thing. I set you totally free. You're totally free. Because I don't need any cause of doubt, because there is no cause of doubt. Doubt is not caused by certainty at all. Okay, doubt is not caused by certainty. And reality is certainty. There's nothing in reality that causes doubt. So what could bring doubt about? My own desire, just this whimsical desire to believe in it, is the only possible cause of it. The world, existence, the universe has nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. And yet, the way the world appears to us, there's no question about it, that it appears to be causing doubt. That's what we designed it for. So as we go forward now, as I'm going to mark the calendar year, the 20, what is it, the 21st, what's today? I don't even know what today is. Today is the 17th, Tuesday. Wednesday is the 18th. Thursday the 19th. Friday the 20th. Okay, so the 20th of January, we'll make that the calendar date. The United States, because that's a new president, takes office on the 20th. And so really this is a important date as far as marking it and say, okay, we really have to have skillful means now. We have to have skillful means. We have to have skillful means. We have to be on it, on our game. Okay, we have to be on our game. And I am. Okay. I am on my game. And it's letting go of any demand that the world present, any intimation of doubt to you. Letting go of that. Now, I don't know too many other teachings that teach this. Comes from Jesus. A lot of great teaching comes from Jesus. A lot. So we have skillful means here, very skillful means to practice. And nothing bad happened to me when I set the world free. Nothing bad has happened to me. Nothing sublime has happened yet. But I understand there's a, that I put a delay mechanism in there. Simply, I don't want to be shocked too bad by too quick of a response. Scary. So I expect at some point As I keep working on this, the world will appear sublime. So I'm getting ready for that in my mind. Wow, wowing the transformed world. This is a wow, transformed world. Expect a transformed world at some point. We don't have any concrete expectations about it all, but we certainly wow it. We're ready to wow whatever arises, even a transformed world. Let's put it that way. And but we don't try to fixate some sort of concept of what a transformed world would look like or be like, anything like that. It would be wow, okay? I mean, we're just going to see wow. I mean, that's the best way to maybe to approach it, is just, instead of a world, we're used to seeing it, the world will just be this wow, okay? It won't be a world, it'll be a wow. A 360-degree wow is what it will be. So prepare for that, prepare for that. So we have the tools going forward to get through whatever comes about, and people are really starting to, everyone that I listen to is on edge, and for various reasons, right? And it's just like they're saying, oh my God, this is just going to be like, we're terrified, and they're stressed out, and because change is scary, right? And not all the change may be so great. I see it as a lesser of two evils situation here, but that doesn't mean it's going to be wonderful necessarily, right? There's going to be hullabaloo. I mean, it's going to be turmoil. There's going to be quick turmoil coming. And yet, we have this wonderful, wonderful capacity here to just say, no, we've got it, we've got it. No worries. We have the tools. We have the necessary tools. So, no panic here. And I keep, you know, working on my weight also, just working on that. Oh, man. I got a good reading on the scale this morning, a really good reading. Not what I'm still aiming for, but it's, you know, it's good. It's good. I'm getting skinnier, a little bit skinnier. Just, you know, half a pound is a big step when you're getting real low. It's hard to, you know, take off the weight. It gets really difficult without feeling weak. I don't want to starve myself. But tomorrow, I hope I get it. I hope a little lower. I hope a little lower. Didn't eat a lot today, that's for sure. And then I worked out like crazy today. Just absolutely crushed it all the way around. I started out in the morning with stretching, and then I went to the core ab work, and really hit that hard. Really hit it hard. Then I did the flex training, the core flex training that I do, like, and then hit that hard. Then I did massive leg work, stair leg work, and then I did push-ups, gas station push-ups, and then more core twisting, and then more ab work in the evening. And so, you know, I just hit pretty much in some strength, some weight work. So I hit just about everything today, actually. Just hit about everything. Moderately strong, not fanatical, but moderately strong. So it was the stair work was real strong. Really crushed that. Really crushed it. Set a new record for myself, how fast I could do it. And so I'm really hitting on all cylinders nutrition wise. Just I made this incredible smoothie in the morning. It's just amazing. Banana, four leaves of kale, sunflower seed butter, almond milk, chocolate protein powder. All sorts of goji berries, cherries, cranberries, all sorts of berries, pumpkin seeds, and a whole bunch of coconut, and yeah, that's that. I think that was the smoothie. Maybe some other stuff too. And then later on, I made a and then I got some fresh squeezed orange juice. Been drinking that, and they made a smoothie of Oh, the Odwalla, green goodness, protein, green goodness, drink with all the different, algae, spirulina, all this green stuff, along with fruit juice. And then I put in like a third of a bag of spinach and blended that up. So I got a tremendous amount of kale today, tremendous amount of spinach, along with, all everything else. It's ridiculous, ridiculous. Just so I know, it's fun. It's fun. It's a good for a laugh, just consuming all the stuff that's supposed to make you feel good. Yeah, I feel pretty good, so. Maybe it's helping. And hopefully I can handle this, all the workout is. But I feel, I set a new record, a speed record, because I'm lighter. I really felt that I weigh less, and that helps. It helps in agility, nimbleness. I feel I can move quicker and easier. And yet I haven't sacrificed much strength. I don't feel I still have the strength there. There's a fine line between thinness and strength that you don't want to, lose too much weight if you don't want to lose your strength. But I think agility, core strength and agility is better to have than upper body strength, the bulk. I feel that it protects you from all sorts of injuries and troubles, and you can sidestep stuff really quickly. Someone was telling me today a story about he was carrying this huge beam, wooden beam, on his shoulder, and it was wet outside, and he slipped, and the beam was coming down on him. He thought it was gonna take off his head, and he used his left arm to push the beam and jumped out of the way, and it somehow it missed him. He thought it was gonna then get his crush his leg and everything, and it missed him. He was able to. He said, "I was able to jump out of the way like a cat, sidestep." Sidestep it. And this is the kind of agility we want. We want to be able to have this quick agility, like a cat. The quick adjustment, real quick adjustment, just a spring, have a springiness to us, have a springiness. And I have to work more on that. My knee is causing me, still causing problems. I'm trying a new regimen where I get home, I ice it. I ice it really good. And then later on, I put some heat on it, because during the day it starts getting sore. I mean, I'm doing so many workouts, it's gotten sore, and I think I need to ice it for a while to keep the swelling down. And then once the swelling's down, after a while, then start bringing a bunch of blood, more blood back, blood flow through heat treatment. So I have to keep doing that. Unfortunately, if when my knee recovers, I feel I have a lot of agility. And I think being agile, both in your mind and body right now, is really important. We don't want to feel stuck. And so I notice all sorts of agile movements I'm doing now. I say, "Oh, that was useful. Oh, that's helpful." And the will to do four stairs at a time, it took tremendous will, tremendous will. A yoga girl was there, and she thought she was helping me out. She says, "Come on, you could do it," because I was resting. It was just brutal. I had to take rest. It was so brutal. And she says, come on, you could do it." And I think she thought I was doing singles maybe, and I'd just been was w out of gas. And I told her, "I'm doing fours." I don't. She didn't hear me, I don't think. And so she thought, "Oh, this poor guy, this poor old guy." It was like, some young yoga girl crushing the stairs, and she thought, "Oh, this poor old guy. I'll give him some encouragement, But I'm doing quads. I'm doing four at a time. Come on." Nobody's doing that. I'm the only one I've ever seen do that. I believe. I may have been. I think it may have been this athlete with long legs. That may have done it. He was running it or something. He was extraordinary. But other than that, no. It's really difficult. And so, the wrong impression, oh, this poor guy needs help. And not understanding the will that it takes. takes. I took so much will and determination to do it. But I did it. And I took a hit, you know, to my pride. So someone's thinking, oh, this poor guy struggling with singles. I'll give him a pep talk, you know. And this is easy. So it's easy to misinterpret people in the world. Like myself, people have always misinterpreted me very badly because they think, oh, this guy, poor guy, you know, he's just struggling so bad in life. And, you know, he's just having such a difficult time. And, yeah, he seems to be just out of gas. And they think I'm doing what they're doing. You know, that's, no. I've been like four times more difficult, or, you know, actually doing fours is just indescribably more difficult than doing singles. It's just a completely different ball game. So it's of course it's very difficult for me here to set the world free from any demand that it present doubt to me whatsoever. Yeah, that's very difficult. So of course I've had a difficult time here. Anyone would, taking this path. But people don't have no idea that's even possible, so it never even crosses their mind that that's what I'm doing. So they just think I'm, you know, having a difficult time here in this world. And at some point they're going to be rather surprised, I guess. But I can say that, no worries. Who could possibly see that? You couldn't see that. You're trying to be helpful, and that's fine. So don't feel like shocked. Uh-oh, I shouldn't have said anything. No, it's perfectly okay. But man, does that get your total body. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it now. I'm going to feel it in the morning, I'll tell you that. I did the ab roller too. I mean, that put it out really far and then hold it. So you can hardly hold it anymore, then pull yourself back up. So I'm putting like strain on my body that, you know, requires the core to stabilize. Work really hard to stabilize. I'm putting this really intense strain that requires this stabilization. And that strengthens the core a lot. It's coming along. It's coming along. But you know, you always feel like you could actually be a lot better. That's how I feel. I don't feel that strong in any particular way. But you know, it's part of just feeling confident right now. Just being strong, flexible, agile, good at balancing. I keep doing balance work, and I'm, you know, pretty good at that. That's a real workout too, for your mind. Absolutely it is. You can't let your mind wander. You got to really be aware of what your balance is doing at any given moment. As soon as you start daydreaming, suddenly you're starting to lose your balance and you weren't paying attention, and then it's too late. It's too late. So it's good news all around. Good news all around. We're not fearing the future at all here. We're aware for others it may be very problematical, but okay. We still have to take care of our own minds, right? I mean, our own attention, our own attention. We're responsible for our attention. So we just choose not to evaluate anything, because this world's just all about trying to produce doubt, trying to worship absurdity. And people are getting all sorts of doubts. Well, that's what they are looking for, actually. They just want to have their cake and eat it too. They want to have all these doubts and feel good about it. And you can't. You can't. And they just get frustrated, like, well, God has forsaken me. Well, that's the purpose of this world, to believe that God has forsaken us. That's, yeah. And how could we possibly believe that God of perfection, the creations that God created, were imperfect, and created creations to fear certainty and perfection? Because that's what we're saying when we say God created this world. We're saying that God created the means to the purpose of fearing perfection. That's crazy, all right? Why would God do such a thing? That's absurd. God, Jesus said God's a God of love, so God would create creations that love God, which is perfection. So God creates that which loves perfection. God does not create anything that doesn't love perfection. But if we think God created human bodies in this world, then we can't help conclude that God created us, fearful of perfection, and that we got to be reconciled somehow to perfection, or somehow, it just gets very crazy when you go down that road. Very crazy. And there's no truth to it at all. God did not create anything imperfect at all. So there's no fear of perfection at all created from God. And yet, since we're freedom itself, we're free to imagine imperfection, imagine that we're imperfect, imagine doubt, pretend that we have doubt, but it's not real. There's no real doubt at all. Let's see if this is working. I don't know if this thing's working. I hope it is. Yeah, it is. At least, how's the audio? It's good. It's good. All right. Fantastic. It's important for everyone to realize that, yeah, we do have the tools. Okay. We're not bound by madness, really. It's just a silliness for us to say, oh, yeah, God created this impermanent, this realm of impermanence and death and all this, so that we would have all these doubts about God. Why would God do such a nonsense, silly thing? Ridiculous. And if God, what God creates is eternal, then we're supposed to have eternal doubt of certainty? Come on. If we're just really willing to look at it becomes silly, the tales that we've told ourselves and continue to tell ourselves. Now, we are projecting all this upon a mirror, our own desires to doubt God. And so all this just is a reflection of our own desire to doubt God, and that's all there is to it. Just because we thought that, if we could doubt God's perfection, then we could claim that we're the ones that are perfect and not God, and that we created God. Of course, the problem is then we would have created imperfection, which means that we must be imperfect too. So it really doesn't work, does it? Not only is it impossible, but logically it doesn't work at all. We could claim, well, we're perfect, but we created imperfection. Well, what perfection creates imperfection? It's absurd. So even if we think we've turned the tables on God, we say, uh-oh, wait a minute, got a problem here. If God's the only way we can turn the tables on God is to believe that God's imperfect, and then we believe that we created God. But if God's imperfect, then we must be imperfect too to create imperfection. And then we try to say, well, we create both perfection and imperfection. But if we're creating perfection, where in that perfection could there be imperfection? So what do we, it's. But we end up thinking that there's two-ness. There's both perfection and imperfection. But where does perfection end and imperfection start? See, this is a question, isn't it? So, uh-oh, that's a troublesome question, isn't it? Yeah. If we create perfection, then how is that, where's the border to perfection? And isn't that a limitation on perfection, that it comes to an end somehow, somewhere? Because if it doesn't come to an end, how can we say that there's anywhere where imperfection could be? Right? So we have to understand that perfection and imperfection are mutual exclusives. You can't have both. But we think we can have both. That's how we try to solve this very, slippery slope of ridiculousness, actually. You say, well, I think, oh, we can have both, human and divine, both perfection, imperfection. Quote-unquote God, meaning really ourselves, what the God that we're trying to make ourselves, we're trying to elevate ourselves to being the prime creator. We have this problem, so we say, well, we create both perfection and imperfection. But that's a very, very shoddy kind of reasoning, isn't it? Logic. Very suspect. enough so that we say, yeah, that can't possibly be true. That there's something really wrong with our what we're doing here. We're trying to elevate ourselves to be the prime creator. And it's claimed that we created God. So it's a really beautiful to see this, isn't it? Say, hey, wait a minute. We've just uncovered a real core aspect of our confusion here. And again, in order for us to believe that we're greater than God, we have to believe that God is imperfect. Because nothing could be better than perfection. So if we want to be greater than God, we have to be perfect, then God has to be imperfect. But then how does a perfect creator create imperfection? If we're the perfect creator God, how do we create the imperfection of God? The other God, that just doesn't add up, does it? Then we must be imperfect too. But if we're imperfect, how are we greater than God? Who's also, we claim, imperfect. And then you say, oh, I got a problem there. So we've just been wandering around in this swamp for so long. And we don't need to wander much longer, do we? It's all just, dissipating. And it's just seen as just silly. A silly little whim on our part. And then if we say, okay, we say, well, we're both imperfect, but then we say, but we have the means to become perfect. The world and the universe will help us is like the training ground where we can become perfect. We can think that way too. Like then we need time, space, process, and form. So we think, well, we have to have time because that's the only way we can become perfect and be greater than God, who remains imperfect, who's not in this world, so to speak. And so it gets so convoluted, doesn't it? All this desperate attempts to just deny what we actually are doing, which is trying to be greater than God. And trying to believe it's possible. That's all we've been doing. And so what the mirror that we call the universe is reflecting to us is our desire, to be greater than God. And therefore, we have to believe in imperfection. We have to believe that God is imperfect. We have to doubt certainty. And so we claim that this is God's work, and yet we say, oh God, it's really, we're suffering, we're dying, everything's impermanent, this is terrible. You can't possibly be perfect. That's the meta message of it all, isn't it? But it's not just our own thought desires that is being projected, mental desire that we see God as imperfect. We're just seeing our own desire. We're not seeing God at all when we're seeing the universe. We're not seeing God. We're looking in a mirror of our own desire that we see. We want to see God as imperfect. So we look at people sick and dying and aging and struggling. Everybody has struggles right now. I mean, you don't come across anybody that isn't, like, how you doing? Oh, I got some severe addiction problems. I got some severe health problems. I got some severe stress. Everybody's on edge. It's suffering. It's just amazing. And we certainly see this, and we start doubting God. Say, wait a minute, this is terrible. So imperfect, isn't it? That's our own desires, but we don't have to see it that way. We don't have to see any of that. It's a choice. It's not real. None of it's real. No suffering is real. No misery is real. No evidence of imperfection is real at all. No evidence of that is real in the slightest bit. It's just wishful thinking on our part. Being projected so it seems like we can imagine it comes from God. It's God's handiwork. So we project, we mentally think we've projected it upon something, so we could think it's not coming from us. And yet it is. It's just like looking at, like Ram Maharshi said, it's like looking at a mirror and thinking that the eyes in the mirror are the actual eyes, you know, instead of a reflection. If you look at a mirror, you see your eyes in the mirror. If you start thinking that the eyes in the mirror are your real eyes, and not the ones looking at the eyes in the mirror, then you're going to get very confused, very confused. It's mental projection projects and thinks that you know, the projection is real, and we get all confused. And it's purposeful confusion. It's purposeful. This enables us then to believe the nonsense of God being imperfect, you know. It's like that. So you hear this and you just say, huh, that's really interesting. This answers a lot of questions. Maybe he answers too many questions for you. This is where the wow comes in. And you just wow it and you say, well, I'm not going to measure how many questions are answered. It's enough to hear it. And I know I've heard it clearly, so let me just wow it now. Don't come up with any conclusions. Don't try to measure anything. The wow is the one conclusion for everything. You just heard it. Wow. That's it. That's all you have to do. Because once you've heard it, you've heard it. Like once you jump in a pool, you're wet. You don't have to like measure the wetness, right? Think about it. I mean, you're wet. So, I mean, you're saturated. So once you're saturated, you're saturated. Let it do its work. You don't have to help it along. It will sink in. It will sink into you, and you just make sure that you don't panic, and start to analyze it. Start thinking about it, analyzing it, measuring it, projecting. Say, well, what am I going to do with it? You know, what's the future going to be like? What are my expectations? Don't try to manage your expectations. Just let them reform, naturally. Based on what you've heard, they will reform. Your expectations always reform up until a point, and ultimately, you know, when you unbind the world from your wishful thinking upon it, then that's a big shift in expectations, and I can't speak to that at this point, but. Expectations as we're working here, they reform, but they're much softer, much more transparent, much less limiting, so it enables you then to get to the deeper clarifications that we did here. That's a result of my expectations being softened up so much, so they don't bind me so badly, and I expect to get to this information. I mean, I'm not surprised. I'm pleased, but I said, wow, that's great. But I'm not overly surprised. Whereas if you haven't worked on your expectations and you got to this kind of information and clarity like this, you would just be stunned beyond belief that you'd be able to do this. Because it would be totally outside of your expectations, really. So that's why we wonder why you have to go about things gradually. We have to go about this gradually because our expectations, you know, familiarity with our expectations, that works to slow us down. It's a break that that's there. But it does work. It does work. Because I feel like, oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, I can look at it this way. It's not a problem. Whereas, you know, 10 years ago, I would have been just like, Eureka! This is the greatest insight in the history of the world. This changes everything. And my mind would have just been, you know, flying a million miles an hour. And just, I would have been so ecstatic and dancing and just saying, oh my gosh, this is just the most awesome insight. How did this happen? How did this happen? How did I get this? You know, and my mind would have been fired up and asking questions and say, oh my gosh, what can I do about it? What am I going to do? How can I get this information? I would have like a meltdown, panic, go into panic. But now I see it and I laugh. I just laugh. I say, that's funny. How silly. You know, just, okay. It's a nice workout for the day. But I expect a good workout. And what I do, I just full stop on the wow. I don't have any thoughts about it one way or the other. Really, I'm just neutral about it. Just neutral, okay. Had a good workout. Wow. Just that. I had a, you know, good workout. Wow. Totally different story. because my expectations allow this. They say, not a problem. This is pretty much, in line with what you've been doing. It's a little deeper, but you're used to going a little deeper, so it's nothing to be, nothing to worry about. Nothing too unexpected, right? Nothing too unexpected. It's the unexpected that throws us into shock and then panic if we don't block the panic. Even when the unexpected is really great, especially when it's great. I mean, this information is fabulous. But if we don't expect it, it's too much. It's too much. So even when we expect it, it's a lot to handle, and we have to use our skillful means of just wowing this. Wow. So, what helps drive me is desperation. I mean, I'm in a circumstances of my survivability right now are not good in practical terms. So I feel desperate. I feel desperate. Like I have to really just give it everything I got and set the world free. And Jesus promises me the world will then take care of you in an awesome way. No worries at all. It will take care of you. So I need that. That fires me up because I've been blessed with desperation. That really is a nice motivator, I'll tell you that. It just things like everything could just fall apart any day for me, just completely fall apart. So I'm like, wow, I got to get it right now. I can't wait for tomorrow. So that's how I feel, is feeling full on push right now. We have so many factors, but you name it, and it's fragile. You name it, and it's fragile. And probably a lot of you may be in similar situations, feeling like, boy, my whole sustainability of my life seems so fragile. I don't have good survival skills at all because I've always believed that I'll set the world free and the world will truly take care of me as Jesus says it would. So I've never really planned to have survival skills. So I don't have them. I don't have them. I did. There's so many things I do. And I went into the store today. It was a security store, video. It was all about security, electronic security. And it's like another world. I mean, you can't believe how the world is going right now. And the amount of tech gadgets that are flooded the world are just billions. It's just, there's just so many choices. New stuff constantly being pumped out. And I have no interest in that at all. It's just like you're supposed to like just be your whole life is just apps. It's all about security. And what technology's motto is making your life safe and secure. And this is what people have fallen for. So I'm willing to sell my soul out to be safe and secure. But the way to be safe and secure is release the world from your demand. That it seemed to be seems to be the cause of your doubt and insecurity in the first place. That's the way, not medicine and not all this video surveillance and safe and secureness, all that kind of stuff. That's not the way at all. That's folly, actually. Where are we at here? Oh. Not even in an hour. Well, we're about an hour. That's just a good mark to hit, and it's getting kind of late. So we're going to go through a rainy cycle again here. It changes. We're not used to it, and we just dried out from the last one, And so this is mentally, it's tough on people here. We struggle with it, believe it or not. We really do. We don't. We kind of panic. We don't know what the heck's going on. When it just gets a, three storms one after the other, it's very unusual here. Pow, 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 with a break one day in between. We have one Wednesday, we have one Friday, and we have one Sunday. The one on Sunday is supposed to be the strongest. So everything's already saturated, a lot of water be flowing, and then Sunday is supposed to be, pop us pretty good. And, we just have to love it and get through it. I don't know how I'm going to get through it. Don't even have a raincoat. I'll get soaked, maybe. Yeah, right. But driving becomes hectic, mudslides, it just everything becomes jammed up and people get nervous and tense. It's just we're just not used to bad weather here. But we'll see. God will get us through it and find some, positive way to engage with it in the right way. Meanwhile, we have this thing, inauguration coming up on Friday. And expect stormy weather in the world. Whether you think it's positive or negative, it's still stormy weather. And people are going to be very shocked and upset. Most obviously, that's going to happen. So we have these wonderful tools here. Just have faith in that. Wonderful tools. Super effective tools. Tools we didn't even know that we had, that's possible to have, right? Unfortunately, I've already experienced the willingness to free the world. I said, well, you don't need to do anything for me at all. You do not need to do anything for me whatsoever. You're completely free. You're absolutely free. But Jesus says the world is it will have such gratitude. Really, it's just yourself having such gratitude to yourself that it will spare no effort to give you the royal treatment as far as taking making sure that you help spread this message everywhere. You'll be taken care of. That's what Jesus tells us. Now my arm's giving me pain too. My knee and now my arm. That's what happens when you try try to get in shape, is you get pains now and then. What can you do? You just have to keep on doing the best you can. But it's not super great getting in shape. It's you don't it's not it's you're sore, you're tired, you're sore, you get some pains from the muscles. Rarely do you feel good actually because I work out something work out almost every day, maybe take a break now and then. So I'm feeling pretty tired all the time, plus dieting. So it's not like I feel great. Now, if I stopped working out for a week or so and did a lot of stretching and stuff, maybe one day I'd feel pretty good. But generally, that doesn't happen because then you start backsliding. So it's no bowl of cherries at all. It's almost like you have to keep it up every day, but that makes you tired. It's pretty weird thing. If you reach a plat, you don't reach a plateau, and then you can say, "Okay, I made it." And now I don't have to work out anymore and I'll feel great. No, you start immediately, you start losing strength and flexibility and everything. It starts going away. So there has to be like some plateau where you keep working out and doing stuff, but not really heavy. So you're suffering and painful. But keep the keep yourself toned really nicely. But even then, you start backsliding some, no question about it. All right, I think that's enough. Very great. That's it. Stop catching.